الحمد لله الذي جعل الحمد مفتاح للذكر وسببا للمزيد من فضله ودليلا على آلائه وعظم، ثم الصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا وحبيب قلوبنا قاسم المصطفى محمد، اللهم صل على محمد آله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين، لا سيما بقية الله في الأرضين أرواحنا له فدا. أما بعد، فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، قال قائل منهم لا تقتلوا يوسف وألقوه في غيابة الجب يلتقطه بعض السيارة إن كنتم فاعلين، صدق الله العلي العظيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته أمين
وعليكم
المؤمنات.
السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
First and foremost, I give my condolences to all of you on the occasion which we are commemorating the Shahadat of Imam Hussein, his companions, and his Ahlul Bayt, alayhim wa salatu wa salam. As we have been speaking about over the last few days, about empathy. And of course, our direction that we are going is to understand how the event of Karbala, how our mourning for Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam helps us to understand this social and emotional skill of empathy, and how does it direct us towards justice and establishing justice, direct us towards social justice. As we've empathy is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has created all of us with. He has placed us in His creation. It's mawadda and rahma, love and compassion. But of course, as we see, whether we look at the news, we read a newspaper, we just remember certain things in our history, even our own history, sometimes there are people who we may classify, we may say that they lack empathy or they have no empathy. And for this, I've used a certain word. I said, you know, they're empathy, meaning that they have some sort of love and compassion, but it's displaced. It may not be in the right place. However, one psychologist uses perhaps a better term, and it's a very interesting term, and we'll focus on that a bit. And he calls it empathy erosion. And erosion means, you know, it's going away or it subsides. So what is empathy erosion, or that kind of lack of empathy, or empathy that is in the wrong place? It's displaced. It's not as it should be. It's not the desire and compassion that he desires to see among his creation. And of course, if we want to look at what type of empathy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to see within His creation, again, we look towards the most favorite creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And He sent the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam rahmatin lil alameen, as a mercy, as a source of mercy to the entire world. A symbol of mercy that reflects the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to His creation. And as we mentioned, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His mercy encompasses everything, that creation that believes in Him, that creation that does not believe in Him. He has given them life. This is a mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has created that creation. And as we know from one of the hadith al-Qudsi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كنت كنزا مخفيا فأحببت أن أعرف فخلقت. He says, I was a hidden treasure and I loved. It was the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of being known that He created. So creation was brought forth out of the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of the hub of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when that love and compassion which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created within his creation begins to erode, and of course that will erode among those creations that we understand like human beings and perhaps among jinn as well, who have free will, who have choice. They can choose to be good or they can choose to be wicked. They can choose to follow what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed in his revelation and through his prophets and through his awliya, or choose not to observe that. So when mankind chooses not to accept that, this is what, again, we will frame as this empathy erosion, because it erodes the empathy, this hub, love, passion, the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should have for one another. And of course, in psychology, they have their own, they speak about the mind or the imbalance of the mind, these type of things. But what I want to say is actually a little bit more deeper than that. And this is why we established that this emotion or the socio-emotional skill of empathy, it has a spiritual component to it. That on one hand, yes, it connects us to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it also connects us through to other individuals. One of the interesting, I would say, things which will help us to kind of understand this empathy erosion, kind of grasp it and actually see where this has or been spoken about within the Islamic text or how we can frame it. They say that emotions or corrosive emotions, things which, again, wipe away at a person's empathy, whereby he's not looking at another person empathetically, then there are four things which causes, or at least this individual says, that causes empathy erosion. And again, by understanding this, we're going back to that one concept that we spoke about earlier, and that is empathic perception. Again, understanding how we connect, or actually how we don't connect to someone. So what is that thing that is hindering us, or maybe sometimes hindering other individuals from connecting to us or connecting to other people? And that is these corrosive emotions. So one of those things, the first of them that is mentioned, is bitter resentment. So if a person has resentment against someone else, then yes, that is going to erode their empathy for that individual or for those individuals. One of the examples that, inshallah, we perhaps speak about a little bit more later, particularly when we come into the context of the events of Karbala, is perhaps Yazid. He's one good example of that. And we can see this in his poem that when the Ahlul Bayt, when they were ushered to Damascus, he recited this poem, and this poem is recorded not only in our books, in the books of Ahlul Sunnah, that he read this poem stating that only if my forefathers from Badr, they can see me now. See how I have done, what I have done, how I have taken revenge on Bani Hashim. So this bitter resentment that Yazid, he held in his heart, and perhaps you can say Muawiyah himself had that resentment, which led him to, again, to pull the Khilafah and maintain the Khilafah for himself, and also to appoint his son Yazid, breaking the covenant that he made with Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi wasallam, again, resenting the loss of power of Bani Umayyah and the rise of Bani Hashim. This is perhaps one of the things that we see, that's why there was no empathy there. The second corrosive emotion that leads to a lack of empathy is desire for revenge. That individuals, they want to get revenge. And again, Yazid is perhaps the poster child of that. based on that poem that he wrote. And he read out that, again, may my forefathers, would they be happy and smiling at me that I've taken revenge for them, for what has happened in al-Badr. The third type of corrosive emotion that sometimes one can have that will lead to a lack of empathy is blind hatred. Again, you hate someone or you dislike those people, individual, simply because, you know, maybe you've been told or you've heard something, or your perception of people or individuals has been distorted by another group of people. And so therefore you build a hatred for an individual. And to some extent we can see that in the event of Karbala, that this perhaps came about with the people of Kufa at one point, although they knew who Imam Hussein Ali Hafiz al-Islam was, but were persuaded to stand with Ibn Ziyad, to stand on the side of Yazid against Imam Hussein. And they developed this, again, this dislike for the people of who were on the battlefield against Imam Hussein and his companions, to the point that they killed them. Or even the people of Damascus, for example, this is perhaps a better example, that, again, when the Ahlul Bayt were being ushered into Damascus, as some say that it was a strange scene, there were a few people who were sad, who were crying, who were mourning, who actually knew what happened. But a vast majority of the people of Syria, they were celebrating, because they had been told that, oh, well, there were some foreigners trying to attack the Muslim world, and the Khalifa Yazid, he stopped that attack, and these people are being ushered into Damascus. So there were people celebrating. And they had hatred in their heart for those individuals who they thought that, oh, well, these are just some individuals who are attacking the Khalifa. And so they were blinded by, again, the media at that time, the announcements at that time, what was being announced. So they had blind hatred for, again, the Ahlul Bayt, until, of course, the Ahlul Bayt, they came there, and people slowly began to realize that, no, this is the family of the Prophet, the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So these are the three. The fourth corrosive emotion, which is a lack of empathy, is a desire to protect. And this is kind of an interesting, you could say, corrosive emotion, that you think, well, how is it that a desire to protect? Yes, if you are desiring to protect something, and that thing may not be worthy of protecting. I'm going to contextualize this by the events of Karbala, but that thing is not worthy of protection. But perhaps a person thinks it is. Perhaps they are under some sort of, they do not understand the reality of that thing, so they're trying to protect it. And so therefore, anyone who stands in their way of protecting that, again, they're not going to have empathy for them. Again, we see the example of this in Karbala. And we see it initially with Hur ibn Yazid al-Riyahi. Again, because he was protecting, but he thought that he was supposed to be protecting Khalifa, that no, well, you cannot rise up against the Khalifa. And so when he was ordered to go and to encounter Imam Hussein alayhi wasallam and to accompany him to Kufa, and then eventually stopping there in Karbala, he was given the orders, no, don't come into Kufa, but stop in Karbala, stop at that place. So he stopped there and did not allow Imam Hussein alayhi wasallam to go forward or backwards, not to move anywhere. Even after Hur, he was given water by Imam Hussein when he first encountered Imam Hussein alayhi wasallam. He was given water, and immediately after that, Imam Hussein says, well, look, why don't you just leave and allow me to go about my way? Neither will I go to Kufa, nor will I go back to Medina. I'll just go somewhere else. But Hur was like, no, I have my duty. I have my duty. I have my responsibility. And I have to accompany you to Kufa. This is before he got the order to, I have to accompany you there. And Imam Hussein alayhi wasallam, when he heard this from Khur, he says, Thakalatka ummuk. He says, may your mother weep at your loss, meaning that a mother, when you say, meaning that may this child pass away and die, and so that that mother, a child who for her. And so Imam Hussein said these words to her, again, because he was under the impression that, oh, I have to protect the Khilafah. I have to make sure that the everything is stable within this government and governance. This is the impression that Hur he had. So a desire to blind, desire for revenge, and having bitter resentment. These are things which leads to the corrosive, these are corrosive emotions that leads to a lack of empathy. And of course, some of the psychologists say sometimes some people actually just have psychological issues, which also lead to empathy. But nonetheless, if we look at those first four things, what is stated that when a person is or has that lack of empathy, is not showing empathy towards anyone else, quite often is because they're a state where they see themselves as more important than others. A state of what we call in Arabic, ananiyya, the state of the ego. And as the psychiatrist said, it's in a state of I, that, well, there's nothing more important than me, than I. So this indicates on something. It shows us something. The ego, that when a person is focused on themselves and focused solely on something that is important to them, and they're not connecting with other individuals to understand their feelings, to understand their pain, to understand that, well, how can I support this individual? How can I, again, share in their happiness or either share in their sadness, support them in either case, in the right manner? Why? Because they're so focused on. And this is something Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he points out to us in this type of niyya. It states in Surah Al-Furqan, chapter 25 of the Quran. In fact, there are about four verses, inshallah. We will kind of focus on those today in this where Allah speaks out this kind of inward focus on ourselves, which will hinder us from connecting to others, which will hinder us from having that love and compassion that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to have. It is that which, again, it will erode our sense of empathy. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he states in verse 43 of Surah Al-Furqan, أَرَأَيْتَ مَنَ اتَّخَذَ إِلَهُهُ هَوَى أَفَأَنْتَ تَكُونُ عَلَيْهِ وَكِيلًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, have you not seen that individual who takes himself, اتَّخَذَ إِلَهُهُ هَوَى, takes himself, his own nafs, his own whim, his Lord, as his God. Meaning that that individual wants, that individual sees himself or herself as mightier than others. That individual is self-righteous. And perhaps the best example that we have of this in the Quran is Fir'aun. When Hazrat Musa, he's calling Fir'aun that, look, you know, be just, be upright. Again, understand the pain of Bani Israel at that time. You're oppressing these people. Let them go. Musa never told him, hey, step down out of your position of power. He says, no, be just, be upright. Do not oppress these individuals. But then one of the response of Fir'aun was, Ana Rabbukum al-A'la. He told his people, Ana Rabbukum al-A'la. That he saw himself that, no, you know, not the Lord of Musa is great. No, I am. So he's blinded by his selfishness, his self-righteousness, to understand the pain that he was inflicting upon Bani Israel. So this is perhaps one of the best examples of that. If we also look in Surah Al-A'raf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he points out again to us this sense that individuals, they can turn inward. And what makes them turn inward? What are the things that, again, makes us lose track of connecting with others? In Surah Al-A'raf, verse 176, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَلَوْ شَئْنَا لَرَفَعْنَاهُ بِهَا وَلَكِنَّهُ أَخْلَدَ إِلَيْهِ وَاتَّبَعَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that if we wanted to, then we would have elevated those individuals. We would have elevated that person, biha. Biha refers back to the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the ayat that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed to mankind. And by these ayat, by these signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he would have elevated the station of mankind, elevated the station of that individual. However, that individual, akhlada ila al-ard, that individual connected himself and made an attachment between himself and this world. That what he saw was what was important. So, well, what am I gaining from this world? My wealth, my children, you know, my clan. These are the things which this individual attached to, rather than understanding the ayat and the revelations and the guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Akhlada ila al-ard. And by doing that, he followed, again, his desire. Not looking at, oh, well, if I'm just taking and taking and taking from this world, what about other people? Am I transgressing their rights so that I can have, I can take, I can get? Or am I being fair? Am I being just? Am I being upright? Am I being one of those, not being, you know, careless? So that individual follows his nafs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives a parable about that particular person. Again, continuing this verse in Surah Al-A'raf. فَمَثَلُهُ كَمَثَلِ الْكَلْبِ إِن تَحْمِلْ عَلَيْهِ يَلْحَثْ أَوْ تَتْرُكُهُ يَلْحَثْ ذَلِكَ مَثَلُ الْقَوْمِ الَّذِينَ كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا فَقْصُصِ الْقَصَصِ لَعَلُّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that this person is like a dog. It's like a dog. That if you run them away, that dog is going to be panting. يَلْحَثْ means that they're going to stick their tongue out, again, wanting water, wanting to quench its thirst. Because his ran has made some effort, so he's thirsty. He wants to quench his thirst. Then Allah says, and even if you didn't, you left that dog alone, again, that dog is still going to pant. Yalhath means, again, to stick their tongue out, wanting something, desiring something. So the example of these individuals who akhlada ila al-ard, meaning, again, they only see this worldly life as their beginning and their end. There's nothing else after that. And it's pretty interesting, again, that individual is likened to a dog, always wanting, always desiring something. Again, pointing out certain animalistic traits or qualities that sometimes we have. Instead of being human as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to be, if we had that quality of being human, then yes, we will have that mawadda, we will have that urahma, we will have that compassion, we will have empathy for one another. But when that empathy is eroded, then our state becomes like the state of animals. If we go to the example that we have in Surah Yusuf, again, what was it that Ya'qub, he referred to? What did he tell his sons? The sons, he says, إِنِّي لَأَحْزُنِي إِنِّي لَيَحْزُنِنِي أَنْ تَذَهَبُوا بِهِ وَأَخَافُوا أَنْ يَأْكُلَهُ الذِّئِبُ. He says, I fear that a wolf will eat him. Hazrat Yusuf is speaking about the quality of his sons, those sons. Again, Yusuf and his brother Binyamin, they were from one mother. The other 12 brothers, they were from a different mother. And these brothers, they ganged up on Yusuf. And if you look at wolves, the nature of wolves, that when they hunt, they don't hunt alone. They hunt in packs. So it is a pack and a group of wolves that they go out to attack, again, because they normally, the wolf, you know, those who study animals and animal behavior, say, normally a wolf is not as brave to go on that hunt by himself. Sometimes if there's no other way, and really they don't have a pack, and their survival, it relies upon that, then yes, they would do it. But under normal circumstances, they said the wolves would not hunt alone, because they're not as brave when they're alone. But they gain their bravery when they're in a pack. And this is exactly when we read those verses in Surah to Yusuf. This is exactly what their brothers, they said when they were making this plot. They said, "Nahnu usba. We are a group. We are a clan. And we can do this together. And then once we get rid of Yusuf, then we will become the favorite in the eyes of our father." So, again, these individuals, when we, again, lose that compassion, then we fail to see, as verse 176 of Surah Al-A'raf, it says, we fail to see and recognize the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And trust me, when we read the Quran, if we want to know what those signs are, there are many signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But one of those signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that He created mankind min dhakirin wa untha, from male and female. Another sign from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that, again, He has made us into qaba'il. Shu'ub al-qaba'il. He's made us into tribes and nations. Lita'arafu, that we may come to know one another. Meaning that, like, again, that empathy erosion when we have it, when we are only connected to this world. Oh, my tribe, my nation, my people, my ethnicity, my nationality. Again, better than any other nationality. And I don't have to perceive, again, what is their pain? What is going on with them? Again, that is eroding that empathy, that mawadda and rahmah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us with. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He states in the Quran, in Surah Al-Rum, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ, that is from the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He's created the heavens and earth. مِنْ آيَاتِهِ خَلْقُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرُضِ, and He has created you with بِإِخْتِلَافِ أَلْوَانِكُمْ وَأَلْسِنَتِكُمْ, He's created you of different colors. He's created you with different languages. So those individuals who, again, they follow their hawa, their nafs. In other words, they look only inward towards themselves. And again, they don't see male or female. In other words, they are not connecting to, again, the pains that sometimes women go through, sometimes men go through, sometimes other nations go through, and sometimes other ethnicities go through. Again, they're cut off from that. Likewise, what we see in Surah Al-Kahf, chapter 18 of the Quran, verse 28, again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gives us those things which, again, what will erode our empathy. And here is a little bit more indirect, but I will point them out, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in Surah Al-Kahf, He says, وَاصْبِرْ نَفْسَكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ رَبُّهُمْ بِالْغَدَاتِ وَالْعَشِيِّ يُرِيدُونَ وَجْهَهُ وَلَا تَعْدُ عَيْنَاكَ عَنْهُمْ تُرِيدُ زِينَةَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَلَا تُطِعْ مَنْ أَغْفَلْنَا قلبه عن ذكرنا واتبع هواه وكان أمره فطورا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, He says, be patient, make yourself, make your nafs, make it patient with those individuals who call upon their Lord day and night and who desire Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And do not turn for a second, don't turn away from these individuals wanting this dunya. Nor should you obey those individuals who we have caused their hearts to be neglectful or heedless of our remembrance. In other words, those individuals, they themselves turned away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and when they turned away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, again, disconnected from them, no longer sent them their guidance, because they weren't those individuals who were listening, so then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, again, cut them off. Not that Allah cut them off first, that no, they didn't listen, they are among those individuals, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala springs about that dog, he says, look, whether you do it, or whether you try to guide them or don't guide them, they're not going to listen. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, don't follow those individuals. So what erodes our empathy? One, by not having patience for those individuals who are calling us towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not having that patience. Or being attracted to this world, as we've already discussed. And following the wrong people, just as, again, Yusuf's brothers, perhaps there were some of them that didn't want to do this, but because they were a pack, they were a clan, they were a group, then, well, they went along with it. Khair as well, he went along with the plan of Yazid initially, until he, again, woke up from that slumber. And also being extravagant. Those individuals, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, وَاتَّبَعَ هَوَاهُ وَكَانَ أَمْرُهُ فُطُرًا. Again, they are extravagant. They take things to an extreme. So whenever we do these things, whenever we don't listen, and of course this is one of the advice that Luqman, he gave to his son, he says, well, always be in good company. Be in company of these scholars. He says, because you will learn something, and if you already knew something, you will be reminded of it. He says, and be careful of those individuals who will take you off of the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, in Surah Taha, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he gives us an example, again, what will erode our empathy. Surah Taha, chapter 20, verse 16, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلَا يَسُدَّنَّكَ عَنْهَا. So may they not keep you from that, meaning belief in the hereafter, because right before that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he talks about the hereafter, the akhirah. فَلَا يَسُدَّنَّكَ عَنْهَا مَنْ لَا يُؤْمِنُ بِهَا وَاتَّبَعَ هَوَاهُ فَتَرْدَى. So again, our disbelief in the afterlife. Because if we only believe in this world, we only believe that, well, whatever I do here, I do it, and there'll be no account of taking of that, of my actions before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because there's no hereafter. Then that means that every action, every choice that that person is making is for simply for this world. And simply so that that individual can gain from this world. What other people think, what other people feel, is it hurting or harming other people? They have no care in the world because they don't believe that there is accountability. So not understanding that there's accountability, again, of one's actions leads to a lack of empathy. Surah Al-Qisas. That's chapter 28 of the Quran, verse 50. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِنْ لَمْ يَسْتَجِيبُوا لَكَ فَأْلَمْ أَنَّمَا يَتَّبِعُونَ أَهْوَاءَهُمْ وَمَنْ أَضَلَّ مِمَّنَ اتَّبَعَ هَوَاهُ بِغَيْرِ هُدًى مِنَ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَحْدِ الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ. So again, if they don't answer you, meaning that, again, the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they came, they called the people towards righteousness, towards this muhabba, this love and compassion for one another. But if they don't respond to the message that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent, then know that these individuals, that they are following their nafs. They're following their whims. And whoever is doing this, they will be misguided, and certainly Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not guide the zalimeen, their tyrants. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not guide those who are oppressors. So if we get involved in oppression and tyranny and oppressing others, again, that erodes our emotion. We develop a lack of sense of empathy, lack of care for others. And the last verse 23 of Surah Al-Jathiyah, and that is chapter 45 of the Quran, where again Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he makes that statement of people being self-righteous. أَفَرَأَيْتَ مَنَ اتَّخَذَ إِلَهَهُ هَوَى وَأَضَلَّهُ اللَّهُ عَلَى عِلْمٍ وَخَتَمَ عَلَى سَمْعِهِ وَقَلْبِهِ وَجَعَلَ عَلَى بَصَرِهِ غِشَاوَةً فَمَنْ يَهْدِي مِنْ بَعْدِ اللَّهِ أَفَلَا تَذَكَّرُونَ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, have you not seen that individual who, again, takes his whim as his Lord, as his guide, as his Rabb? And that individual, because he does that, he is misguided. And again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cuts the guidance off. Again, because that person is misguided, whether he is sent guidance or he's not sent guidance, it's the same. But this particular character, or this particular type that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking about in Surah Al-Jathiyah, he says, أَظَلُّهُ عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ, that he is misguided while having knowledge. And then there's a veil that is put over his eyes, his heart, over his ears, meaning that even though you speak truth to them, again, they won't hear it. It will enter in one ear, as we say, it will go in one ear and comes out the other. That person will not hear it. Meaning that that individual is so self-righteous, though they know the truth, they will not accept it. And again, we find this personality, again, that lacks empathy, even in Karbala. And subhanAllah, again, if we just look at the individuals who are there and we really understand who these individuals were, look at their history. Take the most wickedest individual of them all, Shimr. Again, we know Shimr, who took the head of Imam Hussein. This is an individual during the lifetime of Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib, alayhi salatu wasalam. He stood with Imam Ali, on the side of Imam Ali, in the battle of Safin. In the battle of Safin against Muawiyah. But now the son of Muawiyah, Yazid, becomes the Khalifa. Now he's standing on the side of Yazid, the son of Muawiyah, against the son of Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib. He did not have knowledge. He did not know who Imam Hussein was. But there was, again, a selfish motive for his actions. أَخْلَدَ نَفْسَهُ إِلَى الْأَرْضِ, that he, again, was looking towards his gain in this world. What would he gain? What would he gain out of this? أَخْلَدَ إِلَى الْأَرْضِ. And this is perhaps one of the beautiful, well, examples, or actually, I'm not saying beautiful examples, but perhaps one of the examples of this statement that Imam Hussein, alayhi wasallam, he made. He said, "Man ahabbana," that who loves me? Who loves us? Who loves the Ahl al-Bayt? And again, we are ordered in the Quran. We're told in the Quran that for this Rasala, for this message, that there's nothing in return except for love of the Ahlul Bayt. Mawaddat al-Qurba. But what is that love? And how is that love? How do we empathize with the Ahlul Bayt? Imam Hussein, he said, Man ahabbana la yuhibbuna illa lillah. Ja'ana nahnu wa huwa kahatin. He says that whoever loves us and loves us truly for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that on yawm al-qiyamah, that we will come, and according to some of the other hadith, this is a little bit a shortened version of that, that we will come on the day of judgment, meaning the Ahlul Bayt, we will come with that individual who has love for us for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We will become before Rasulullah, and we will be like these two fingers. We will be kahatin. We will be together like these two fingers. And according to some of those other riwayat that also express the same meaning that those individuals who have love for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, love the Ahlul Bayt for the sake of Allah, that those are individuals who act as we act. They are the individuals who obey our commands. Then he says, وَمَنْ أَحَبَّنَا لَا يُحِبَّنَا إِلَّا لِلدُّنْيَا فَإِنَّهُ إِذَا قَامَ قَائِمُ الْعَدْلِ وَسِعَ عَدْلُهُ الْبِرُّ وَالْفَاجِرُ. He says, but if that person, he loves us only for the sake of this world, then when you think that, well, how can our love for Ahlul Bayt be only for the sake of this world? Again, look at Shamar. What did he think his benefit was by standing with Imam Ali? Again, perhaps he knew that when Imam Ali is in a battle, he, especially if Imam Ali goes out to fight, anyone who stood in front of Imam Ali, they will be defeated. So he perhaps thought, oh, well, you know, I should be on this side. In fact, we read about one of those individuals during that time that during the day where the battle was, he was standing with Imam Ali because he knew, he said, well, if Ali goes into battle, then no one would defeat Imam Ali. But at night, he would go and he would be in the camp of Muawiyah. Imam Ali asks him, he says, what are you doing? Why are you doing this? Either you stay at this place or you there. Stay there. He says, well, if you go into battle, I know that no one's going to defeat you, but you know, these guys have the best meal. They have the best camp, you know, the luxuries. So he wanted to get the best luxuries of this dunya, but also wanted to spare his life in this dunya. So who loves us simply for the sake of this world, as Imam Hussein, he stated, he says, when that individual, and perhaps he's talking about Imam Zaman, Ajah Faraju Sharif, he says, when he comes, and whenever anyone comes to establish justice, then that justice will compass that individual, whether they are good or bad, whether they are birr or fajr. So that love that we should have for Ahlul Bayt should be love lillah, for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is something that perhaps no one expressed as good as Khair on the day of Ashura in the lands of Karbala. Khair was, we read his history, that he was from a tribe, Bani Tamim, which was one of those tribes that was not resentful or had any animosity against Rasulullah. Was not like the Bani Umayyah, who was perhaps resentful that Bani Hashim had risen, that before Bani Umayyah they controlled the economics, but now Bani Hashim, that their significance was more than that of Bani Umayyah, but now they're trying to, again, reclaim or regain their position, their worldly position. Or Bani Hanifa or Bani Huzail, these are other tribes that were a bit at odds with the Bani Hashim and Rasulullah, even though they came into the folds of Islam. But the Bani Tamim, from which Khair was from, that they had love for Ahlul Bayt. They didn't have any animosity. Khair, as we said, he was simply under the impression that, well, in order to maintain stability in the Muslim world, I have to obey the command of the Khalifa. So he accompanied Imam Hussein to Karbala. And on the day of Ashura, when he realized that Umar ibn Sa'd, that he is going to wage war against Imam Hussein, he began to reflect and he began to think about his position, what he was doing, and what his choice was at that moment. Khair, he stated, Khudaki qasam, may jannat or dozakh ke darmayan intiqab karunga. Or khudaki qasam, may jannat me kasi cheez ka intiqab nahi karunga. Khair, he saw himself in a position that he had to choose between heaven and hell. He had to choose between the side of righteousness and right with Imam Hussein, or to stay in the army of Yazid, which was an army that was doomed for hell. Khair had stated, إني والله أخير نفسي بين الجنة والنار والله لا أختار على جنتي شيئا لو قطعت وحرقت حرصت. I will never choose anything above paradise. Even if I had to be cut to pieces, even if I had to be burnt, I will never choose hell over heaven. It said, Khair, he mounted his horse at that moment, and then he began to rush to the camp of Imam Hussein. And he came towards Imam Hussein until he stopped. He got off of his horse and he bent down. He knelt down before Imam Hussein. He told Imam Hussein, "Ana sahibuka alladhi habasatka 'ani ar-ruju' wa ja'a bika wa wallahi ma dhannantu an al-qawm yablughuna bika ma ara wa ana ta ابن الى الله فهل تراني من توبه. Or he said, I am the one, Hussein, Imam Hussein, I am the one who has made you stop here. I am the one who did not allow you to go back. I am the one who kept you in this place. I did not know. I never imagined that these people, that they would begin and they wanted to wage war against you. So I repent to Allah. Oh Hussein, is there repentance? Do you see for me repentance? Imam Hussein, he says, yes. Imam Hussein, see the empathy of Imam Hussein. See the compassion of Imam Hussein. That Imam Hussein and his companions, he knew that they will be martyred in this land. They will be martyred on the plains of Karbala. And it was Khair who brought them there. But Imam Hussein said that, yes, you will have your tawbah. You will have forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, Khair, he went out onto the battlefield because he had requested Imam Hussein. He says, allow me to be the first to be martyred. Allow me to be the first to give my life for you, Hussein, because I am the one who was the first one to oppose you, to bring you here, to make you, put you in this position. He said, Khair, he went out onto the battlefield, and like a champion fighter, he went and he fought the enemies of Allah. He went and he fought. They said that he was reciting these words, Inni ana al-hurru wa ma'a wa al-dhaif adribu fi a'naqikum bis-saif. I am Khair, and I am with my guest. I will strike you on your necks with my sword. أنا خير من حل بواد الخيف أضربكم ولا أرى من حيف. I am defending the best and the most noble individual who's ever stepped foot on this land. I will strike you down and I see no remorse in my actions. And then Khair, he went out and he fought a brave battle. He fought very bravely, but how much could a thirsty man fight? And this thirsty man, he was not standing before those individuals. He was not fighting those individuals who was like Imam Hussein, who would give them just even a little bit of water to quench his thirst. How much could this thirsty man fight? They said that in Hur, he was struck down on the plains of Karbala. And as he was being struck down on the plains of Karbala, according to some maqtal, he was giving his final farewells to Imam Hussein. As-salamu alayka ya Aba Abidillah. Imam Hussein, he rushed out on the plains of Karbala. But before he reached his companion, Hur, انتقل الى رحمه الله. His soul had gone back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Imam Hussein, he took Khur, he took the head of Khur and placed it in his lap. And he said, Ya Khur, anta al-Khur kama sammatka ummak, hurun fi al-dunya wa hurun fi al-akhirah. He says, Khur, Khur means the free one. He says, Oh Khur, you are as your mother has named you. You are free in this world, and you are free in the hereafter. Meaning that Hur's repentance was accepted. The Tawbah of Hur was accepted. And may in this night, Bihaqi Hussein, by the right of Hussein, just as Hur, he acts the right of the repentance from Imam Hussein. He acts by the right of Imam Hussein, the right that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has over Hussein. He asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that repentance. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also forgive us in this night. Shab shab tawba as giriye kinari Hussein. توبة جزء كري براي حسين. This is a night of Tawbah. Tawbah on the side of Hussein. What is Tawbah? What is Tawbah except for crying for Hussein? Allahumma ighfirni bil Hussein. Kasi kemi gay man Hussein yam bimola bayad ke bihar barin namaz shibashi ghawra. That person who says they are Husseini, that person says that they have the love of a Hussein and they are attached to Hussein, then their namaz, their salat should show that they have love for Imam Hussein under all kinds of pressure. Like Imam Hussein and his campaigns, they prayed under that condition in Karbala. Kasi ke mige man Husseiniyam hamishe ba tuhmat baghibat dige hamra namishe. That person who says that they are Husseini, that they love Imam Hussein, then these individuals, they do not backbite. These individuals, they do not accuse anyone. This is what it means to be Husseini. Kasi ke Husseini mishe har lahze har bar banish zabanash namide khalq azar. That person who has become Husseini, that person who has love for Hussein, then this person will not lash out with his tongue to harm the creation of Allah. Allahumma ighfirni bil Hussein. Hussein jaan, Hussein jaan, ebi min sharmande hastam, bakaram hizar bar dilat ruban shikastam. Oh Hussein, oh Hussein, my beloved Hussein, look how shameful I am by my actions. For a thousand times I have broken your heart, meaning a thousand times I have done things that Hussein would not be pleased with. This brings me before Hussein in a state of shame. Allahumma ighfirni bin Hussein. But we ask Allah, by the right of Hussein, by the right of our Imam, our Master, our Mawla, to forgive us in this day as He forgave Hur, as He forgave Hur. إن لله وإنا إليه راجعون سيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون. اللهم بحق هذه المجلس الحسينية اغفر ذنوبنا واستر عيوبنا وقضي حوائجنا واشفي مرضانا ورحم امواتنا وعجل فرج مولانا صاحب العصر والزمان واجعلنا من اعوانه وانصاره والمستشهدين بين يديه وتحت لواء بحق محمد واله الطاهرين. باطم حسين.
يا حسين يا حسين برادر علي بسم الله.
Can you hear me?
Yes.